I'm new. I don't know what to do. Good morning, everyone. So I have a few announcements. First thing, I know Miss Debbie was hard at work for a few days making the new flyer for what's happening in the month. So they're up by the front of the door wherever you guys walk in. There's a table to the left and they're getting ready to walk out. Grab one of those. It has everything that's going on this month from the women's Bible study all the way down to kids. So Wednesday nights are in full swing again. The elementary age has JBQ, which is Junior Bible Quiz. So that's a fun thing for the kids to come in and learn everything from Genesis all the way to Revelations, right? A little bit of fun in it because it's a competition style. We have youth, which is Regenerate. Right now we're in the middle of an I Spy series, which is finding God in the details. So we've been kind of discussing different ways to find God in details of stories and finding God in details of everything of everyday life. And then the adult kitchen table style Bible study. That is a mouthful. I was not ready for that. So in the back room where Marco is right now, the adults come in on Wednesdays and they have their own Bible study in there. And usually Debbie has all of the coffees, all of the teas, and snacks and stuff like that for you guys. And then welcome cards. Just so happen to have one in my back pocket. These are new. She kind of revamped them. Alex and I have been kind of low-key giving Debbie a hard time. Every time we go somewhere with the youth, we take one of their cards and bring it to Debbie, and I think that's the new thing we're going to do. So every Christmas, we're going to give her about 1,000 of these from different churches. But it has all of the things. So if you're a first-time visitor, it has a thing for you guys to fill out, and it has prayer requests on the back, but it goes all the way from first time to this is my church. It has next steps on it, and it has a thing for you to fill out on the top to kind of let us to keep in contact with you guys and kind of follow up with you guys every once in a while. If you have been here, we are updating things, so please take a moment and fill one out. Kind of a summary of that, so I wish I would have looked at that first. Then after you're done with that, you can drop it in the offering bag whenever it comes around, or you can put it in the box in the back by the door. So now we're going to pray over offering. Do we have offering people to walk around with the bags? Oh, there they are. All right, so dear God, we just thank you for this opportunity to once again worship you, and of all days, the day that we celebrate your resurrection. We pray that not a day goes by that we forget your resurrection and that we don't have to just look forward to Easter to celebrate that, but we thank you that we have a day on the calendar where everybody stops and thinks about that. We pray that you just continue to have your way in the worship, continue to have your way in the word, and continue to have your way in the day. We pray that you just continue to just fill us with your presence today and allow yourself to be known, and we do this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Easter. We're going to go ahead and start worship, so if you want to stand and maybe move around, do something different, we're just going to have fun worshiping the Lord this morning.
Will praise. dead will rise. Through you our hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free. Yes, I am free. I am free to run.
I am free to run.
I am free to dance.
I am free to dance.
I am free to live for you.
I am free to live for you.
I am free.
I am free.
I am free. I am free to run.
I am free to run.
I am free to dance.
I am free to dance.
I am free to live for you.
I am free to live for you.
I am free.
I am free.
I am free.
Step out of the shadows, step out of the grave. Look into the wild, don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, graces waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, graces waiting. When the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. When the Spirit of the Lord is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom.
All of your burdens, bring all of your scars. Come back to communion, come back to the star.
The Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom, let there be freedom. There's power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain. Chain, break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. To break every chain, 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 break every chain.
There's an army. chain, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, Lord, break every chain. Come and break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Sent his son. If you're a little unfamiliar with what's happened here, God has given the gift of tongues and the gift of interpretation of that in a message that we can understand. And so refreshing that the Lord sent his son, as we will continue to sing about, but that he is here. He is here for you. Just to think that Jesus was willing to lay it all down for every sin that you've committed, for every sin that you're going to commit, because none of us are perfect. But he is here, and he's calling you for that relationship with him. If you don't already have that, if you do have that, he's urging you for a deeper relationship day by day, to seek after him. Amen. Let's just take this opportunity to draw near to the Lord, whatever that looks like for you this morning. Thank you, Jesus.
Count it all as loss.
As we just start this last song, I encourage you guys to just seek freedom in this, because that's what today's about. It's about seeking redemption and seeking freedom and being free. I feel like somebody is just holding back today, and you just need to let go. Maybe come up to the front, move out of your pew, something, do something different. We may not be singing the songs you're looking to hear this morning or singing it the way you want. We may mess up, but we're here to worship the Lord, not sing the songs we want to. Amen. So, there we go.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. Was another in the fire standing next to me. Was another
the things unseen and this reckoning. I know I will never be alone. Joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. There'll be another in the fire, standing next to me. Be another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding, how good you've been to me. Joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. Count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. Count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be.
Right now, in his presence, just soak this in. Just a few more moments, just soak it in. Just talk to him. Thank you for your sacrifice. Lord, thank you for everything that you have done for us. Thank you for everything you're doing right now, even though we don't see it. No matter where we are at, no matter what life situation is we are in, you are in it with us because we are not alone. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you on this Resurrection Sunday for you, for loving us. No matter what, for caring about us. So, Lord, just thank you so much. as we continue service today, continue to have your way. Have your way in our minds and in our hearts, Lord. Lord, whatever it is that you have for every one of us today, let us be open to it. Let us be open to you and your word. Lord, continue to have your way, because you're just getting started. Lord, we love you. And we ask this in your mighty name. Amen. Thank you, guys. It's wonderful to just have a worship team. We have several, actually, if you think about it. And when I say this, I mean all of them. That they love Jesus. And then they don't just get up and sing. It's not a concert. We enter the presence together. And it's amazing. It's amazing. So thank you guys so much. So in praying for today's message, the question kept coming to mind, why Jesus? Why? Why Jesus? So that is what we're going to explore today. Now, if you're sitting there or if you're watching at home and you're like, okay, Deb, I've heard this my whole life, just another Easter message. We're here. We're breathing. God's got something he wants to say to us because he's already started through worship. So don't tune out because the Holy Spirit's just getting started. So as long as we're open to his word, man, the things that can happen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, just let your word be heard above all else. Let you be heard and let you be seen in this message today, Lord. Lord, you just completely have your way. We ask this in your name. Amen. All right, so we're going to go back 3 days' time, a lot of years ago. Matthew 27, verses 27 through 31. Some of the governor's soldiers took Jesus into their headquarters and called out the entire regiment. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. They wove thorn branches into a crown and put it on his head, and they placed a reed stick in his right hand as a scepter. They knelt before him in mockery and taunted, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they spit on him and grabbed the stick and struck him on the head with it. When they were finally tired of mocking him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him again. Then they led him away to be crucified. So we're starting out today, leading up to the crucifixion. Continue with me. Matthew 27, 32 through 44. Along the way, they came across a man named Simon, who was from Cyrene. And the soldiers forced him to carry Jesus' cross. And they went out to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull. The soldiers gave Jesus wine mixed with bitter gall, but when he had tasted it, he refused to drink it. After they had nailed him to the cross, the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. Then they sat around and kept guard as he hung there. A sign was fastened above Jesus' head announcing the charges against him. It read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. The people passing by shouted abuse, shaking their heads in mockery. "Look at you now," they yelled at him. "You said you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Well then, if you're the Son of God, save yourself and come down from the cross." The leading priests and teachers of religious law and elders also mocked Jesus. "He saved others," they scoffed, "but he can't save himself. So he is the King of Israel, is he? Let him come down from the cross right now, and we will believe him. He trusted God, so let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" Even the revolutionaries who were crucified with him ridiculed him in the same way. So we see, man, he's hanging there. And his arms, he was beaten said he was broken. His body, he was unrecognizable. And his arms, he was hanging there. And in order for him to breathe, he had to pull himself up. So he was suffocating on top of it. Oh, the sacrifice there. Okay, let's continue. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. At about 3 o'clock, Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you abandoned me?" For some of the bystanders misunderstood and thought he was calling for the prophet Elijah. One of them ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, holding it up to him on a reed stick so he could drink. But the rest said, "Wait, let's see whether Elijah comes to save him." Then Jesus shouted again, and he released his spirit. At that moment, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two, from top to bottom. The earth shook, rocks split apart, and tombs opened. The bodies of many godly men and women who had died were raised from the dead. They left the cemetery after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city of Jerusalem. They appeared to many people. The Roman officer and the other soldiers at the crucifixion were terrified by the earthquake and all that had happened. They said, "This man truly was the Son of God." So I want us to notice a particular verse this morning, verse 51. It says, "At that moment, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and rocks split apart." The curtain, or the veil, depending which translation you read, but it means the same thing. The same verse in the Passion Version says, "At that moment, the veil in the Holy of Holies was torn in two from the top to the bottom. The earth shook violently and rocks were violently split apart." See, in the Old Testament, the veil separated the Holy of Holies, the highest part, from the holy part. And the Holy of Holies passing through the veil only happened once a year. And it was only by the high priest. Now that, the veil being torn, see, I get so ahead of myself that my articulation when it comes to this, just because of the amazingness of the story of what Jesus did for us, I get so excited that I start talking over my own words. So, the veil was torn when Jesus died. The veil in the Old Testament separated the holiest part of the temple from the holy part. And through that veil in the Old Testament, only the high priest was allowed to go in there once a year. And what he did was to ask for forgiveness, to make right the sins of the nation. And so that veil separated God, the holiness of God, from humanity. But Jesus, when he died, that veil tore. Which means, which is amazing for us, because that took away the separation of God from humanity, opening up us to be able to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Oh, and it's so, oh man, I'm so glad. I couldn't imagine living. I mean, read Leviticus. If I had to do that, guys, I'd be in trouble. All those rules and regulations, there's no way. So, let's jump to Hebrews chapter 9. Verses 1 through 15. Now, I know there's a lot of scripture today, but it's the best way to talk about Jesus on it's the best way to talk about Jesus ever. So, bear with me. Don't bear with me. Enjoy it. Get in your mind right now. Say to yourself, "I like scripture. This is going to be good." Okay. So, as we read this, picture it. Okay? All right. That first covenant between God and Israel had regulations for worship and a place of worship here on earth. There were two rooms in that tabernacle. In the first room, were a lampstand, a table, and a sacred loaves of bread on the table. This room was called the Holy Place. Then there was a curtain, and behind that curtain was the second room called the Most Holy Place. In that room were a gold incense altar and a wooden chest called the Ark of the Covenant, which was covered with gold on all sides. Inside the ark were a gold jar containing manna, Aaron's staff that sprouted leaves, and the stone tablets of the covenant. Above the ark were the cherubim of divine glory, whose wings stretched out over the ark's cover, the place of atonement. But we cannot explain these things in detail now. When these things were all in place, the priest regularly entered the first room as they performed their religious duties. But only the high priest ever entered the most holy place, and only once a year. And he always offered blood for his own sins and for the sins of the people that had committed in ignorance. By these regulations, the Holy Spirit revealed that the entrance to the most holy place was not freely open as long as the tabernacle and the system it represented were still in use. This is an illustration pointing to the present time. For the gifts and sacrifices that the priest offer are not able to cleanse the consciences of the people who bring them. For that old system deals only with food and drink and various cleansing ceremonies, physical regulations that were in effect only until a better system could be established. And the better system is Jesus. So we don't have to sacrifice lambs and go through the grain offerings and all that. Let's keep reading. So Christ has now become the high priest over all the good things that have come. He has entered that greater, more perfect tabernacle in heaven, which was not made by human hands and is not a part of this created world. With his own blood, not the blood of goats or calves, he entered the most high, holy place once for all time and secured our redemption forever. Under the old system, the blood of the goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer could cleanse people's bodies from ceremonial impurity. Just think how much more the blood of Christ will purify our consciences from sinful deeds so that we can worship the living God. For by the power of the eternal Spirit, Christ offered himself to God as a perfect sacrifice for our sins. And that is why he is the one who mediates a new covenant between God and people, so that all who are called can receive the eternal inheritance God has promised them. For Christ died to set them free from the penalty of sins that they committed under that first covenant. So Jesus came, and he's the high priest. And we get to go straight to him. Straight to him. There's no middle ground. We don't got to burn incense and do all that crazy stuff and kill this heifer and that and do that. No. We get Jesus. Okay. All right. This part. This is the part. Okay? You with me? I know. I just like to look at your smiling faces. Okay? All right. So, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit, and whatever the Spirit of the Lord is, wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So all of us who have had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we are changed into his glorious image. So, Jesus, by going through the suffering, being nailed to the cross, by dying a horrid death, by being the ultimate sacrifice for humankind, he tore the veil that separated us from God. He tore it wide open. And then he rose again 3 days later. So there is freedom. And that's why Jesus. If Jesus hadn't come, like we already said, man, trying to get forgiveness, that I don't wanna imagine it. I don't wanna live in that world. But Jesus did come. He came, he suffered, he died for us. He could have called down 1,000 angels. But he was fulfilling the cup the Father had given him. And because of that, when we accept him into our lives as our Lord and Savior, we get to experience freedom. Now, when it's talking about the veil is taken away. It's referring to Moses. Moses went, and when the Ten Commandments on the stone were given, Moses wore a veil over his face. What that veil did was it blocked others from seeing the glory of God that he had received from being in his presence. But it also didn't allow people to see the glory of God fading on his face. So with that, when it says, but whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. We all have a veil. It says it a little bit in 2 Corinthians before that. It says, I'm backing up here. 12 through 15. Since this new way has given us such confidence, we can be very bold. We are not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the people of Israel would not see the glory, even though it was destined to fade away. But the people's minds were hardened, and to this day, whenever the old covenant is being read, the same veil covers their minds so they cannot understand the truth. And this veil can be removed only by believing in Christ. Yes, even today, when they read Moses' writings, their hearts are covered with that veil, and they do not understand. So that veil, we wear it. It can hide stuff. And that's dangerous. But man, whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We sang that this morning. The Holy Spirit, Neely and I texted her last night, hey, what's up? I'm going to tell a little bit of the story. And she was like, this is on my heart. I said, go with it. And then I sent her a picture of the scripture. And she was like, what? And I was like, go with it, girl. You got this. God's got you. He knows what he's doing. We don't sometimes. So I told her, I said, sometimes I don't. I lean on him, and I trust his word. And so, man, for the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Oh, there is freedom when we ask Jesus into our life as our Lord and Savior. There is freedom. Jesus came. He tore that veil. He opened that wide open so we could be saved and have that personal relationship. Man, we get, okay, so anytime that we are set free from anything, whether it be physically in this life or whatever it is, we're free. We're free afterwards. But in this case, when we have Jesus in our lives, the freedom that comes, it's freedom from the bondage of sin, which leads us to spiritual death, ending with a trip to hell. It's freedom from generational chains, that alcoholism, that abuse, that anger. We don't have to carry that on because there is freedom in Jesus Christ from it. We can be better than the generation above us, than our parents, than the things they did. We can still love them and forgive them, but man, we can change it because there's a freedom in Jesus Christ, and that is the only way that it's lasting change. It's it. It's the only way there's lasting change. There's freedom from our past, from past sin. Once we ask Jesus for forgiveness, he forgives it. Now, the enemy likes to bring it back up a lot, but that's when we just have to be like, no, Satan, get behind me. Jesus forgave me, and I'm following him. There's freedom from condemnation, which is guilt from the enemy. And guilt is not from Jesus. Scripture says there's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. There is no guilt in Jesus. There is conviction, but conviction is good because we all need it. We're all human. We all need corrected sometimes, or a lot of times if you're me. So don't just take my word for it. Don't. Go read it. Romans 8:1 is one of those places. Don't ever just take my word. Read it yourselves. Paul said it in Scripture. We got to read it. So, freedom. It's a wonderful thing. That veil that covers us all, that's not so good. That veil hides things. When Moses wore it, like we said, it didn't only cover the glory of God, but it also covered the fact that that glory was fading. So let me ask, how's the walk with Jesus going in your life? Have we asked Jesus in as our Lord and Savior and had that veil removed? But yet, guilt is keeping us from freedom. Or we're leaning into temptation, and that's keeping us away from experiencing that freedom that Jesus died that we could have. And what I mean by that is if we have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, are we inviting him into our lives and asking for forgiveness? Or are we living like he doesn't exist and allowing guilt from the enemy to control us from growing closer to Jesus and sharing our freedom and the freedom that's available with others? Now, maybe you haven't asked Jesus into your life and you've never experienced that freedom fully. Or you have and it's been a long time. Either way, it's not too late. It's not. Jesus, he loves you. He loves every one of us. He tore the veil for us. He suffered. He suffocated and bled out for us. Man, God sent his only son. I can't even imagine that. Makes me sick to my stomach to imagine my little boy hanging from a cross to love us so much. Man. And then for Jesus to say, okay, Father, let your will be done. There's a lot of times in this life we get told by people that they love us over and over, but their actions say otherwise. Or they only love us until they get what they need. Or they only love us because we can do something for them. But the love of Jesus, that doesn't walk out. That love of Jesus doesn't talk behind you. That love of Jesus doesn't stab you in the back. His conviction may not feel good sometimes. But just as I will correct the twins if they go to run out into the road, Elijah doesn't like it when I correct him. But I'm not going to let him get hit by a car because I want to be his best friend. No, I'm going to correct him because I love him and I care about him and I have to teach him. And we are the same way. We got to be taught. And how are we ever going to be taught if we're just allowed to do whatever we want with no rules? We won't. And so, man, Jesus, that veil, I don't want that veil. I don't want it covered anything. I don't like it, but I want to be convicted because that means I'm walking with him. We're human, you guys. We need a Savior. And we got one. We do. We needed a Savior. We needed a sacrifice to save us from an eternity in hell. And hell is not a good time on a bar stool. It is not. I've said that joke my pre-Jesus days too, and then I read about what it actually is. Hell is not a good time on a bar stool. Hell is a lake of fire and gnashing of teeth. It is awful. It's not sitting around and drinking beers with a buddy. It's not. It is awful. Why did Jesus come and save us? If hell was just a vacation, I've heard it put this way so many times. Earth is as close. I mess it up every time. All right, I'm gonna look at Mick Jackson when I say this so I can stay focused. All right. If we know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, Earth is as close to hell as we'll ever get. And if we don't have that relationship with Him, Earth is as close to heaven as we'll ever get. I heard this in, I think, Bible study a few weeks ago. And that, it just made me think, man. And I'm not making any of this up. I just want you to know that. Trust me, there's scriptures here. That, and the only way I can, someone showed me love once by telling me the truth, by telling me about Jesus. It took me a while, but I finally said yes to Him. It changed my life. And I never went any other way, ever. And I want every one of us to feel that way too. I want every one of us to say, man, Jesus, that's it. I gave it that try and He changed my life around. Because that's what He does. He's in the freedom business. Freedom from sin, freedom from bondage. Man, that anxiety, that depression that wants to grab a hold of us, there's freedom in that. He uses different areas. He uses therapists. He uses medication. But you know what? He doesn't walk away from us and tell us to get over it. Jesus says, I'm in this with you. I know you're low right now, but I'm in this with you. Let's walk through this together. I got ways. Come on, let's do this. He doesn't just say, get over it. Now, there might be times in life where it might be, and He still says, okay, come on. There are times He says, all right, Debbie, all right, you come on, you whined enough, get over it. And I'm like, yeah, okay, you're right. But that's about minor human inconveniences that I have to let go. That's it. So, we have a Savior. It's Easter. It's why we're here. We're celebrating. We are celebrating the freedom that has come through Jesus. And it's beautiful. God so loved the world, He gave His only Son. For you, for me, for the people we love, for the people we don't love. He loves us all the same, whether we like Him or not. I'm grateful because there are people who don't like me, and I'm glad He still loves me. Right? I mean, come on. I'm very grateful for this. Jesus tore the veil, and we get to choose whether or not to have ours torn too. He did. He tore the veil, and we get to choose whether or not we want ours torn too. To experience that freedom from sin and condemnation, we get to choose Him and say, I want freedom. We get to do that. That's amazing. It is. And I pray that you've heard God's heart in this today. Because, man, there's freedom. There's freedom from the bondage, from the lost hope around us in our community and our families. There's freedom there. And it is beautiful. It's not always easy. But it is good. Will you join with me in prayer? Now, if you're here, and you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, but you're like, I want this veil to be lifted. I want to experience that freedom from sin. I want to experience that through forgiveness and the power of the Holy Spirit. If that's you and you're here or you're online and you're like, I'm certain, I've been certain, but I want Jesus. Even if it's been a while and you're like, no, I want this in my life again. Those generational chains need to be put to bed. They need to be broken. And I want Jesus in my life. If that's you, I would love to pray for you. And all eyes are closed. Would you lift up your hand? Thank you, thank you. Thank you. If you would, repeat after me. Dear Lord, thank you for coming and dying for me. Please forgive me of my sins. Come into my life as my Lord and Savior. Let my life be yours now. Take this veil. I will follow you in your mighty name. Amen. Now, with all eyes closed still, if you have a personal relationship with Jesus, but it's not as close as it once was, there's a little drifting in there. There, the excitement, the discipline is gone. But man, you want to just reignite that fire. You just want to walk close with him again. If that's you, would you raise your hand? Because I'd love to pray for you. Thank you. Thank you. Lord, right now you see your children. They know you, but they want to walk with you again, closer and closer. So Lord, right now we pray that you come in and you reignite that fire that's there when we first find you, Lord. That's there when we read your word. Come in right now and just reignite that. Draw them closer to you. Give that thirst for you like never before. To where a day doesn't go by and we want to get into your word again. We want to talk to you. That we call on you when life gets hard and all we can do is put one foot in front of the other. Lord, come in right now and just meet your children. Just let this be a start of it, Lord. A start of that thirst for you again. Lord, we love you and we ask this in your mighty name. Amen. This is just the beginning. I've been saying that a lot lately. I've noticed this. I even texted Corey last night, and Cameron, I think I said it there too. Fresh starts have been on my heart a lot these last couple months because God put them there. Because it doesn't matter how long we've walked with Jesus or how little of a time we have, he's always doing something new in us and through us. And so, a relationship with Jesus, man, that is, it's amazing and it is humbling that he chooses us to share him. It's wonderful. It's completely wonderful. And so, let him continue. Whatever he started today, let him continue that. Invite him in. And just allow him to continue to work and to begin whatever it is. It might be a little bit scary. Say yes. Say yes. We do things for thrill all the time. But man, there's nothing quite like the thrill of saying yes to Jesus. Trust me. And then call me, please, because I want to hear all about it. I'm being dead serious right now. You call me and you tell me about how you said yes to him, and I'm going to be in your corner and I'm going to be praying for you and I'm going to be like, you can do it. Come on. Don't quit now just because you're tired. You got this. I'm being so serious right now. If you want my phone number, come see me or half the people in this room. For real life, yeah. So, but really, you say yes to him. We got each other's back. We're a family. We hold each other's back, and that's all. There's no stabbing. There's nothing. There's no place for that in the family of God. You guys, I hope you're pumped up right now. You ready to go see your families and have dinner and be like, guys, guess what? Jesus. Yep, I'm going to talk about it again. Yeah. Okay, I want you to do that at dinner today, please. Everyone. Okay, so. If you accepted Jesus today, or rededicated, or haven't yet, please fill out a welcome card. We will not spam you. It's not for that. I have a personal gift that I would like to send you, if that is you. And if this is your church, please fill it out so we can update our records. I would greatly, and maybe you'll get a random gift too, on your birthday. And maybe not. I'm just kidding. You're still with me. Okay, you guys have an amazing week. Thank you. I will. And I love you guys. I'll see you Wednesday. I'll see you on Sunday. If you have children, there's an Easter egg hunt outside in the parking lot. If you need a bag, see someone in the back. Shoes. You guys have a wonderful week.